Hello, this is Dr. Grande. Today's question asks if I can analyze the mental health and personality factors that may be at work in the case of Richard Russell. He's also known as the Sky King. Just a reminder, I'm not diagnosing anybody in this video, only speculating about what could be happening in a situation like this. If you enjoy this video, please like it, subscribe to my channel, and consider supporting me on Patreon. I'll put the link to Patreon in the description for this video. So here I'll be looking at the timeline of the crime that Russell committed, then moving to a brief background, and then I'll get to the mental health and personality factors. So starting with the timeline, we move to August 10, 2018. 29-year-old Richard Russell steals an aircraft operated by Horizon Air, specifically a Bombardier-8 Q400. From the Seattle-Tacoma International Airport in Washington State, this airport is also referred to as SeaTac. Now, the manufacturer of the aircraft, Bombardier, is now De Havilland Canada. The plane is sometimes referred to as a DHC-8 these days. This model, the Q400, is a twin turboprop passenger plane that cruises at over 400 miles per hour and has a maximum operating altitude of 27,000 feet. It can carry 76 passengers, and when it was purchased, it would have cost around $21 million. These days, a Q400 would cost closer to $33 million. Richard Russell was a baggage handler at SeaTac Airport. He had never flown a plane before. He came into work that day at 2:36 p.m. At 7:15 p.m., he arrived at the cargo area driving a tow vehicle. The aircraft was parked in this area. He climbed into the Dash 8. He started the aircraft at 7:22 p.m. He then exited the aircraft and turned the nose toward the airfield using his tow vehicle. He climbed back into the plane and took off at 7:32 p.m. He had an unusual conversation with air traffic control and executed a variety of aerial maneuvers, like a barrel roll. Two F-15 fighter jets were scrambled to intercept him. They followed him for some time but did not engage him. He flew the aircraft for 73 minutes before intentionally crashing it at 8:46 p.m. on Ketron Island in southern Puget Sound, about 5 miles southwest of Tacoma, Washington. The investigation determined it was intentional because the flight data recorder indicated that the column was in a position forward of neutral prior to the crash. About 6 seconds before the crash, it was pushed even further forward. Richard did not make any phone calls or other statements outside of what was recorded in his radio communication with air traffic control. Nobody on the ground was injured in this incident. Now moving to his background, there's not much in terms of background available for Richard Russell. He graduated high school in 2008, and he married a year later. He and his wife operated a bakery that they ran together for 3 years. He enjoyed trying different things like experimental recipes and was generally creative in his work. The couple moved to Sumner, Washington in 2015 so they could be closer to his wife's family. This is when he started working for Horizon Air and enrolled in college. Russell earned his bachelor's degree in 2017 and hoped to either become a manager at Horizon Air or to be commissioned as a military officer. He was described as quiet, friendly, someone who liked to play jokes. He was active in his church, he read a lot, and he was considered fairly intelligent. He complained about how little money he made in his job and indicated he never pictured himself in such a low-level position. He was paid minimum wage, which for the position he was in was $12 an hour, not the $15 an hour minimum wage paid to the other workers at SeaTac. So we see a two-tier minimum wage system, which really seems to defeat the whole point of having a minimum wage in the first place. We see that he worked for Horizon Air for almost 4 years before the incident. He was amazed why anybody would want to be a ground service agent, the job he had, because the job involved constant noise, heavy lifting, and what he referred to as gas fumes. I presume he meant aircraft fuel fumes, although there are gasoline and diesel vehicles operated as well at an airport. With all that in mind, let's take a look at the conversation he had with ground personnel. He spoke to someone from air traffic control, as well as a pilot. At the beginning of the recording, we hear air traffic control, I'll just refer to them as ATC, trying to get the Dash 8 to identify itself. This is when it was still on the runway. I can imagine they were pretty surprised by seeing an aircraft on the runway that should not have been there. Then we see that ATC and Russell are talking about his landing options. So he takes off, and they're discussing how he could get back on the ground. They talked about him landing on a runway or in the water. What struck me here is how casual the air traffic controller was about these two options. Both were dangerous, but landing in the water would have been extremely dangerous. So really, it seems like they're talking about both life and death kind of casually. Now again, it's not really clear how much skill that Russell had in terms of flying the aircraft, so landing in either place could have been extremely difficult. Russell talks about wanting to see the Olympics, referring to the mountain range in Washington State. ATC is really just trying to keep him on task, encouraging him to turn left and head back so they won't lose communication with them. They were actually quite polite. Then Russell starts talking about the impact that his behavior will have. He said there are a lot of people that cared about him, and they will be disappointed hearing what he did. He said that he would like to apologize to each and every one of them, referring to himself as a broken guy with a few screws loose, but he never knew that until now. It's interesting he said this because later we find out that he may have been planning this for some time. It's like he was trying to imply this was more of a spur-of-the-moment decision. ATC is still encouraging him, of course, to come back. Then Russell asks if the plane can do a backflip. He complains that the plane is burning fuel much faster than he thought, like his fun will be cut short, or he's facing death sooner than he thought. Both of those could have been in his mind. Russell said that he didn't need much help flying the plane because he had played video games before, but he did complain that he didn't know how to pressurize the cabin and was feeling lightheaded. He was having trouble balancing the oxygen in the cabin. This is something that wouldn't be an issue when he was in the cockpit on the ground. A lower level of oxygen could have affected his behavior a little bit as well. ATC points out a runway called McCord Field where Russell could land. Russell suggests that the people there would rough him up if he landed there, and he could mess something up, and he wouldn't want to do that. So I presume he means that he could crash the aircraft and people could be harmed. After this, he suggests they could have anti-aircraft weapons. It seems like he was trying to be funny, but he really didn't get the venue right. It's like he didn't want to face how serious his behavior was. With the heavy weight of his actions, it was like he was trying to lighten the mood. Russell said that he was not quite ready to bring the plane down and needed to stop looking at the fuel because the level was going down so rapidly. He talks about how someone doing this would probably go to jail for life, saying that he hopes it would happen for a guy like him. In a way, we see an attempt to take ownership, but of course at this point he could still try to land the plane. So it really seems insincere to some degree. Another meaning, though, could be self-hatred, like he wasn't really trying to take responsibility, rather he was just acknowledging how bad he felt he was. He suggests that his minimum wage job explains his behavior, and that this incident may grease the gears with the higher-ups, ostensibly helping his coworkers. So at this point, he does seem to understand that he's committing several serious crimes, but he has an excuse. He was mistreated by his employer. ATC stressed that he should just land, and they wanted to make sure that no one was hurt. Russell starts talking about seeing the orca, the whale. He then says that he doesn't want to hurt anyone, and he just wants the guy he's talking to whisper sweet nothings in his ear. So here again, we seem to have what appears to be an attempt at humor that falls flat. It's almost like he wants people to look at him in a positive way, like all this was just a big joke, and everybody should join in laughing with him. Then he asks, if he can land this plane, would they give him a job as a pilot? ATC told him that he would get a job doing anything if he could pull that off. This is when Richard responded, yeah, right, and then said, no, I'm a white guy. After this, he crashed the aircraft. Now moving to mental health and personality factors. Again, we don't really know a lot about Richard Russell. Looking at the five-factor model, it would seem reasonable to believe that he was high and openness to experience. He was intellectually curious and creative. He had mid-range conscientiousness, probably mid-range extroversion, mid-range agreeableness, and low neuroticism. But then again, he was depressed, and that's typically associated with a high level of neuroticism. So it might have been that he had that one facet elevated, but otherwise he was calm. I'll talk about that more in a minute. An investigation failed to yield any motive for his crime. After the incident, a pilot who had seen Russell in the cockpit of an aircraft flipping switches, when Russell should not have been in there at all, called the police to report it. I guess that pilot was quite taken with the phrase, closing the barn door after the horse is already gone. His justification for not saying anything earlier is that technically Russell was not committing a crime by sitting in the cockpit, and the pilot didn't want to make any trouble with the carrier. His reports are important, though, because they indicate that Russell may have been planning his theft for some time. With no concrete evidence about his motivation, we see a lot of speculation. Many people have found some type of meaning and even elegance in Russell's actions, honoring him with the name Sky King. One of the main theories about his motivation is that he was having some type of existential crisis. He could not find meaning in his life. He felt like he wasn't really living. His actions have become a commentary on modern society and how sensation seekers really have nowhere to go anymore. Every job is highly structured and boring. There are no more true adventures to be had. His theft of a $21 million aircraft and the fact that he endangered people seems to be forgiven quite quickly by many. He's become kind of a folk hero. I don't think Russell is a hero by any stretch, but I think that the existential crisis piece could be part of the puzzle. There's no way to know what's going on exactly, but when looking at everything, including the discussion with air traffic control, it seems as though he was depressed. If this was the case, he hid it quite well from just about everybody who interacted with him. Nobody suspected he was depressed. This is actually not terribly unusual for people who are depressed. What is unusual would be stealing an aircraft and crashing it. Perhaps due to symptoms of depression, he wanted to take one last shot at feeling good, doing something that no one else has done before, doing something that would be the highlight of his life, making him remembered forever, and giving some type of purpose to his existence. Now, about his complaints with the amount of money he made, it's not clear if this is really something that led to his death. I believe he was upset about that, but a lot of people are upset about their working conditions. It seems like Russell just felt like a failure in life. He had a college degree and was working for minimum wage, which is actually not that unusual. Even with all these stressors and other possible explanations, it seems pretty clear that Russell's main mission in doing this was to end his life. He didn't want to harm anyone else, so it really doesn't seem to be about anger or rage, although perhaps he took some satisfaction in destroying an extremely expensive piece of equipment that belonged to his employer. Assuming the aircraft cost $21 million when it was new, in order for Russell to have paid for that, he would have had to work for 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for 200 years, and paid no taxes and have no expenses whatsoever. That's not including other costs like the cleanup, the investigation, the cost of sending the F-15s out to intercept the airplane, the disrupted air travel. So his foolish behavior had a negative financial impact on a lot of people. Many people have said that this was really no big deal. He just took an airplane. It's not like he took the space shuttle or something. What he did was no different than stealing a car. Well, I can see this argument, but it was more like stealing 840 cars, assuming the price of each car was $25,000. If there was a car thief loose in a particular community and they stole 5 cars, people would be upset. If they stole 25 cars, people would be outraged. Yet if they took 840 cars, people would be pleased and turn the car thief into a hero. It's like the stealing your way to fame method of gaining celebrity status. I don't think that's a real thing. Now, others have said the situation is different because he died. Well, it is certainly unfortunate that he died, but it doesn't change the fact that what he did was extremely dangerous and costly. I think one of the reasons he seems more sympathetic is because greed doesn't seem to be a motive. One of the things that really stands out in this case is how he stayed so calm during the flight. It could have been that he was very low on neuroticism, like I talked about, but then we see that whole issue with depression that I discussed. So again, that one facet score could have been higher, but generally, he did seem like he was fairly calm. I think what could have been happening here was that Russell was feeling better when he was flying the plane. It brought him some peace to know that the end was near. Depressive symptoms are incredibly painful, and it's not unusual that when somebody who is depressed decides to bring an end to their life, they tend to feel better for the last few hours or so. I've seen this several times in my clinical experience. It's like a weight has been lifted off their shoulders. They look forward to being out of pain. Russell knew that he would not be landing that aircraft. Once he took off, he knew he would not survive. So he saw a clear end to his suffering. Some people have been critical of the air traffic controller and the pilot who talked to Russell, saying they could have done more to preserve his life. I think they did a good job. I think Russell had made up his mind, so nothing they said would have made any difference. But if he was open to attempting to land the plane, I thought that the content and tone of their messages were helpful, especially considering they were taken completely off guard. They were not judgmental. They were friendly. They put up with his awful attempts at humor. I think they just genuinely wanted to preserve his life and protect people from him. So summing up this case was tragic. I understand the arguments about trying to find meaning in life and making one big dramatic move to try to get that purpose. But Russell's actions were self-centered and destructive. There's no quick fix to an existential crisis, and there's no quick fix to depression, if that's what he actually had. A less glamorous, less dangerous, and more pro-social course of action would be to seek mental health counseling. Those are my thoughts on the Richard Russell case. Please put any opinions and thoughts in the comment section. They always generate an interesting dialogue. As always, I hope you found my analysis of this topic to be interesting. Thanks for watching.